didn't see you there. Well, I'm sorry, I was just trying to put my own ZX Spectrum collection I bought on eBay recently. You see, I want to be known as a 21-year-old guy who owns a ZX Spectrum, so what I'm going to be doing is placing the ZX Spectrum in one of my shelves. You see, for somebody who likes to collect video games and turning all of this into a hobby, it's always fun to talk about the video games that you own. For example, I own Booty on the ZX Spectrum. How about owning a mint copy of Cupid on the NES? And if video games are not enough, maybe you'd like to talk about some other forms of media like movies or television. I mean, who knows? You may even have a copy of No Time to Die lying in your bookshelf without realizing it in the first place. You know, I spent $18 to see Bond die at the end of the film. Now, I know what you're here for, and I know you want me to talk about it because the title suggests it and it needs no introduction. You want me to talk about Gaz's Super Soccer. I mean, come on, look at this. It's got soccer and gay marriage. My two favorite things combined. You know, once I'm done playing this game, I'm gonna be sleeping in my bed questioning why I even choose to review this game for the next few hours. Three Sister Story is an adult visual novel developed and published by JAST in 1996. The game was released on the PC-98 series of computers in Japan, then later got a release on the DOS platform by JAST USA in 1999. Oddly enough, the game received a homebrew port to the ZX Spectrum in 2004. Well, finally, Gaz's Super Soccer was starting to piss me off. The game was presented at a yearly demo scene party in St. Petersburg, Russia called Chaos Constructions, where the coders claimed it to be the very first game to ever exist on the platform. You can put away the ruler now. Now, before you ask, what's the title of this game? Anime Story! You know, I'd argue that Sex 2 was a more creative title than this. Out of all titles you could come up with, you're telling me that this is the best title you could think of? Every anime has a story. What does this story have that stands out above the rest?
Oh, I don't know. Anime?
Good point. Stupid titles aside, this is definitely Three Sisters Story with bastardized graphics.
Cursed!
Now, I know I'm talking about a clone of a popular British microcomputer released in 1982. I wasn't expecting high-res colorful graphics like the PC-98 version, but you can't tell me that this is the best the specy can do. Why not just remove this big-ass border in order to compensate the crusty graphics? Or better yet, why not just redraw the sprite artwork so that it fits the ZX Spectrum's resolution? These graphics were scaled down in the worst way possible that it makes the protagonist's brother look like Gary Oak. Gameplay and story-wise, it's overly simplified from the PC-98 version, making this a bare-bones port that you could probably finish within 30 minutes.
The only problem is that I don't know any Russian, so trying to make the correct decisions later in the game is gonna require a save state, or else...
No, you gotta be fucking kidding me, I have to start over again!
You start the game from the very beginning.
Fun!
Well, color me surprised.
In 2013, there was another port of Three Sisters Story released under a ZX Spectrum clone called the ZX Evolution, and boy oh boy does it look good. The graphics look fairly close to the PC-98 version, given that this modification expands the ZX Spectrum's color palette from 8 colors to 64 colors. The menu layout is reminiscent to that of JAST's earlier games that were released before Three Sisters Story, and apparently composer C-Jeff actually took the liberty to make some AY musical renditions of the PC-98 version of the music, which, believe it or not, it's the same guy that made some of his songs available for the 2004 version. To be honest, I'm surprised at how this version looks. It's even better than the bare-bones port that the Russian Spectrum owners had to deal with in 2004.
It's just a shame that you can't really play it under the Spectaculator emulator, unfortunately. Also, can I take the time to talk about one of the characters' themes in this version of the game? You might as well have my OC's theme be the Data Robot theme from Mario Paint.
Okay.
No wait, stop! I was just joking! Fuck.
Pretty cool, right?
Fuck you.
In 2002, JAST USA released a compilation disc with all three of their DOS games combined into one, titled JAST USA Memorial Collection. Yeah, that sounds like their name to their funeral event. The copy that I have is a second revision released 10 years later with compatibility for Windows 7 computers and... Once you install the game, you are greeted with a boring menu selection screen. You're given the option to select one of the three games. You can start a new game or load from a save state. Unlike the DOS version, the re-release actually allows you to save the game from any point and will load it from there once you saved it. You can listen to the game's full soundtrack either enhanced or the original MIDI renditions.
None of them are great. Playing the original MIDI soundtrack with the default sound font is just crap unless you're using Virtual MIDI Synth as your default sound font. The enhanced soundtrack doesn't even help at all because it's advertised on the cover as improved music, but it's pure and utter bollocks because it's literally pre-recorded MP3 files of the MIDI soundtrack but with a different sound font and with the addition of reverb! Holy fuck do I hate reverb!
Oh, this game has an enhanced graphics mode? Well, fuck you, I hope you like anti-aliasing! Oh, we have a CG gallery? Well, good luck finishing Runaway City without using a walkthrough in order to access the entire CG gallery, you sick fuck! Oh, it comes with 2 free games? Well, hopefully you still have a Windows XP in order to play them!
It feels obvious that this re-release had little to no care put into it. Everything just feels half-assed, and don't even get me started on the 2019 playable online version of the game. I'm not even joking when I say that I've encountered glitches when I first played Season of the Sakura in this version.
What the fuck is this? What the shit?
And you don't want to know how I look like. I used to call myself Resident Fatass for crying out loud. So now that I've already taken a look at almost every version of Three Sisters Story available, including the ZX Spectrum ports, let's take a step back and take a look at the original MS-DOS release prior to the PC-98 version.
Among the 3 JAST visual novels to have been released on the DOS platform, Three Sisters Story is the 3rd and last game released for the platform, with the first 2 being Season of the Sakura and Runaway City. The only differences with the DOS version is that the JAST logo screen from the PC-98 version is missing, not to mention that the option to select MIDI as your source of game music is stripped out in the DOS version. You can't even access some sort of setup file like in any other DOS games that allow you to do that because there isn't any setup file right off the bat. So what's the point of leaving the MIDI files if you can't play the game with them?
You know, if I can't listen to the game soundtrack in MIDI form, I could always listen to the ZX Spectrum's tape loading sounds from their own cassette tapes.
Once you load the game from the DOS terminal, the game launches with an on-screen copyrighted text, followed by another on-screen text encouraging users to email SakuraSoft or to visit their own website for future products.
Sure thing, I'll go ahead and take a look at your website. Just let me go ahead and play this game before I... Ow, my ears.
After that title jingle, we then start the game with a backstory giving context about the situation the main character is in. You take the role of Koichi Sanada, who his father passed away by suicide after being forced out of his power in his very own company. Koichi's mother forced herself to work more in order to pay back the huge debts her husband left following his suicide until she collapses and dies, which leads to Koichi and his brother getting taken care of by different relatives, losing contact over each other over the years. It wasn't until he met his brother again, claiming to have found the man responsible for the death of his father, Shoji Okamura. They both agree on the idea of plotting a revenge against Shoji, with Koichi moving next to the Okamura's house in an attempt to gain trust from the family and gathering information about Shoji in the process. It all seemed to go well as planned, until Shoji disappeared all of a sudden, leaving his 3 daughters behind and with them tormented in fear about the possibility of losing their own father.
That was it? Only get the plot, no ending? Man, Hollywood's gone down to shitter lately.
We then begin with Koichi waiting outside of the Okamura's house. He approaches the front door and Yuki shows up. Yuki gives Koichi his lunch, then fixes his tie. The two have a small conversation about each other's families until, whoop, there's no time for chit-chat, Yuki's on her way to work. While we wait for Emi to come on down, we get further context about the revenge plot. Eichi became a rich man after forming a large trading company. He took custody of Koichi and moved him in a house near the Okamura's. The reason why Shoji was the man responsible for the demise of Koichi's parents is because Shoji had betrayed Koichi's father in a business deal by spreading misinformation about his business in an effort to take over his company. Shoji bought most of the company, which led to Koichi's father's demise, and that's what caused Eichi to plot his revenge against Shoji. And there's Emi. While we wait for Risa, let's talk about Emi. She's the second daughter of the Okamuras, Koichi's girlfriend, and apparently she's got a sharp tongue.
I don't give a shit if she's the lizard woman or whatnot. Who the fuck asked for the shape of her tongue?
Anyway, in an attempt to gain trust from the family, Koichi decided to approach Emi by asking her out. She ignores these approaches by claiming that she hates perverted guys like Koichi. But it wasn't until later that Emi grew a bit closer to Koichi before the disappearance of her father. And with that, here's Risa, the youngest of the 3 sisters. As the 3 head for school, you talk to both Risa and Emi, which is going to be very confusing because the problem that most visual novels are always plagued with is that there are multiple menu options that you have to select in the game. But once you've already selected the option, there's no indication that it's already been clicked. So you have to go through repeating the same lines of that option, and it becomes more of a chore to go through every option to get through the story that way. And funny enough, the re-release actually improves upon this in the slightest.
You know, maybe I misjudged this re-release. This actually has an advantage over the original, so 0.1 for Memorial Collection. You know, that's still not saying much.
The three are running late to school, all because the Queen of Tardiness overslept and had to fix up her clothes. Spanish for Laughter here locks her arm in with Koichi's dislocated arm, which makes Emmy jealous. You know, I hate it when that happens. Risa starts taunting Emmy by asking Koichi out, and Emmy isn't having any of that shit as she starts throwing a temper tantrum against both of them. And with that, we're in school. Or should I say we're finished with school, questionably at 4 p.m. Koichi gives us boring details about his school activities as well as his lunch that Yuki gave him.
Potato, potato, tomato, tomato, let's just shove those tomatoes up our fat asses and go home. You're kidding me. I have to go look for Emmy around the school?
Well, if that's the case, I might as well start with her desk. Okay, how about the other classmates? They might have a clue if they've seen Emmy leave the classroom. No, but this Nakajima guy bought a totally not Gundam game for the totally not Sega Saturn console, which makes this guy run around the hallway like a madman.
Did somebody put him a straitjacket?
After asking Nakajima where Emmy is, he says he doesn't know, so fuck it. I'll go look around the classrooms if I have to. Let's start with the fourth floor, I guess. After interrupting the students and escaping some public indecency that is going on in one of the fourth floor classrooms, I move to the second floor where Risa goes to class. So if anything, Emmy must be in there. Well, there she is. We ask Risa if she's received any detention after arriving late to school. She says no. We then ask her if she's seen Emmy, and she says no. But she does link arms with Koichi again and asks him to go home with her.
You know, I would consider it a waste of my precious time if I keep on looking for Emmy around the school, so fuck it. I'll go home with Risa instead. Are you fucking kidding me?
The game wants me to keep looking for her, or else I can't make any further progress with the story. So after a whole lot of searching around the campus, from the roof to the gym, encountering three girls I don't know and won't give two fucks about, and talking to some of the school staff, we get back to the classroom where Nakajima tells us that Emmy was going home without Koichi? All this time, Nakajima knew where Emmy had gone, and now all of a sudden he remembers as I was fixing to go home after wasting my time looking for her?
I mean, this is stupid. Like, why didn't Emmy just tell Koichi in advance instead of telling Nakajima to tell Koichi? If Nakajima will likely forget once, he might likely forget even the second time. Yeah, great storytelling there. You've made me waste my precious time, not to mention make Emmy look stupid in the process.
After beating the shit out of Nakajima, we go to the park without Risa. Koichi spots Emmy in front of a lamppost crying. She looks at Koichi, and you are given the choice to now act like a dick to her or be caring of her. They both leave the park and head to Emmy's home, where they notice an expensive sports car parked on the side of the house. It's a Ferrari F40 according to the PC98 version.
Of course this was bound to happen, what more could you expect?
Koichi runs to where Eiichi is and pushes him away from Yuki. This prompts Eiichi to act like he doesn't know who his brother is by assuming that Shoji has a son. Welcome to the family, Koichi! After staging the confrontation with Eiichi, Koichi gets close to Yuki and gets bitch slapped by Emmy because she claims he was a pervert all along.
You must give me the name of your oculist.
All is forgiven as poor Risa, after being left alone from school, arrives home. Koichi leaves the three sisters alone and goes to his home, evaluating the situation he just witnessed. Eiichi calls Koichi and asks him to have a personal meeting at the park. He runs to the park and meets up with his mug-ass brother. Look at this piece of shit, look at this dumb son of a bitch. He knows what he did to Yuki, yet Koichi claims that his brother is a man with good intentions. Yeah, I dare Koichi to look at the picture of the incident and tell me that again with a straight face. Say that he's a good person again, Koichi. I dare you. Eiichi asks his brother how well he is doing and tells him that he doesn't have enough time to socialize with his brother due to work. Koichi, on the other hand, isn't having any of it as he argues with his brother about the incident that occurred at the house. Koichi believes that their revenge plot is over because Shoji had lost everything and left his three daughters behind. But Eiichi claims that it's the beginning of his demise and is waiting for Shoji to commit suicide after Eiichi plans to force the three sisters into prostitution. Koichi opposes these actions by telling the police about their plot to destroy the family, but Eiichi counters it by telling him it won't work because haha, rich people can bribe the corrupt pigs and get away with their crimes. Eiichi spills his guts to his brother, saying that he has killed people and bitches about how his blood money is the only reason why Koichi has a life that he couldn't have otherwise. He then tells Koichi that once Shoji dies, he will leave the three sisters alone, but if Koichi interferes, Eiichi would kill him.
That is, if he had the balls to do it, as he reverts to good person McGee over here, but is still resorting on the idea of punishing the three sisters without the help of his own brother. The brothers part their ways with Koichi returning to his house, re-evaluating the situation. He gets a phone call from Yuki asking him to meet her at her room. He agrees to meet her and then fantasizes about Yuki wanting to have sex with him.
Oh, how fucking original! You might as well undress Yuki with your eyes while you're at it!
Koichi enters Yuki's room and she starts confessing her love to him by... Yuki asks him to stay with her for the night, and you are given the option of being hurt or not.
We're going with no for this scene. And by no, I mean...
No!
I could have sworn I had the highlighter on the refuse option, and now I'm forced to see the intercourse in action. But for the sake of it, I'm skipping over the scene. Koichi covers Yuki up and gets back to his house, thinking about what the hell he just did to Yuki. And that concludes day one.
Hey look, we're not this far into the game explaining the story. Pretty cool, right? I spent 1 hour and 9 minutes playing this game. Pretty cool, right?
It's day two and Koichi goes to the Okamura's house to wait on the sisters, Kacha. Yuki isn't there, but Emi is, and according to Koichi, she looks even more depressed than what she did that day, but, I mean, come on. Hasn't she always been this way since her father disappeared?
Emi hands Koichi his lunch, and Koichi, in an attempt to make Emi feel like her short-tempered self again, starts giving her sexist remarks like saying that she can't cook food, only for Emi to say that Yuki made it. Koichi and Emi go to school without Risa. After school, Koichi visits the staff room where his teacher lectures him on how to set up a good example when in front of a teacher. Well, hopefully Emi is here waiting for me so I can go home. Emi isn't here again, but at least her shoes are still around here, which means that she must be somewhere around the school. Eh, I can wait for her. Or better yet, guess who spends 12 minutes looking for Emi again?
Take a wild fucking guess!
Koichi, where were you?
Who, me? Definitely wasn't wasting 12 minutes of my precious time looking for you around the campus only for you to return to the classroom and losing my temper because of it. No, I'm fine!
Who looked at this? Who looked at this and said, we must have the player look for Emi around this school twice? The first time it was unforgiving because she literally left and never told Koichi in advance, and now this time the writers don't explain why Emi left the classroom only for us to look for her.
At least have the player find Emi somewhere around in one of the classrooms, or just have Koichi wait for her instead of leaving in a state of panic all because Emi didn't return to the classroom. Well, there's a reason for why you're forced to look for Emi. Remember the three girls I talked about on day one? Well, it turns out that you can go to the nurse's room, talk to Nurse Junko, and do a side quest to solve the three girls' problems. And you wanna know how to solve them? Well, it's not an adult visual novel without this in mind.
And let me tell you one thing's for sure, I got 99 problems, but three bitches ain't one. Now let's go home.
We are back at the Okamura's house where Koichi and Emi plan to go shopping for Risa's birthday, which gives Risa a great excuse to stay in detention for being late whether she likes it or not. Koichi gets ready and so does Emi, which, funny enough, you are given the option to be a good boy, stay in the dining room and wait for her, or to be horny and peek at Emi. I chose the correct option this time.
After waiting for Emi, Emi returns to the dining room, which surprises Koichi and causes him to accidentally cut himself while removing the bugs he planted in the dining room. They go to Emi's room where she puts a bandage on him. Koichi asks Emi what's a good to get for her present, to which Emi replies the same thing that Risa told Koichi while he was searching for Emi. Say it with me now.
Think of something to give her!
Think I found the perfect present for her. She'll need it.
Moving on, after shopping for some items for Risa's birthday party, Koichi and Emi are fixing to go back home. Koichi bought a jeweled brooch for Risa. Emi returns, and surprise surprise, their teacher actually pays them a visit. They both talk about Risa's birthday party until she tells them to go back home as it's getting late. Well, fair enough.
As the teacher leaves, Koichi spots Yuki in the middle of the public, which prompts them to follow her. They follow Yuki to the back of a building where she gets past this door. Emi tries to open it because it's apparently morally okay for them to do so without knocking all because Yuki got inside that room.
Now tell me, if you ever saw somebody you knew going past the door to wherever they're going, is it okay for you to follow them and open the door because you saw them going in?
Should I or shouldn't I? Well, he did get past through the door, so it should be fine. Yeah, I might as well.
Hey, don't you know how to fucking knock?
Sorry. Not sorry.
A woman comes out of the room and is immediately attracted to Koichi. She tells him that the entrance to the building is at the front and that he should pick her for whatever reason. She gets back into the room and both Emi and Koichi go to the front, where they realize that Yuki was going inside the back room of a lindry pub, also known as a ranpabu in Japan.
Well, come on in.
What the fuck?
Play a shredder for you inside. You won't be sorry, I can guarantee it.
Hey, you, over there.
Me?
Yes, you, sweet cheeks.
What the hell do you want?
It's happy hour right now. Want to come in? We also have an additional discount when you show your high school ID card. We also have an additional discount when you show your high school ID card.
And? Don't tell me you're leaving this video on a cliffhanger. I don't know, I feel like I want to stop right there. Why? Isn't the ZX Spectrum version the only port that got you into Three Sisters' story and that's the reason why you wanted to talk about it in the first place?
Yeah, but it's an adult visual novel.
So? What, you think it's okay for me to talk about the game while cutting the saucy bits out and try to make this video age-appropriate? Besides, there's barely any gameplay to talk about, it's just me explaining the story.
With all the funny spelling and grammatical errors, tedious gameplay, or should I say lack thereof, and the fact that the majority of the scenes have to have something sexual because it's an adult visual novel, it's really hard to consider this a video game. Sure, it may have a decent storyline with Koichi trying to stop his brother from ruining the lives of the three sisters and trying to save Emmy from his brother, but it's still not enough to catch my interest. Now, if this was an anime movie from the mid-90s, I'd have no problem with it, but as it stands, it's another visual novel with little to no replay value. There are other visual novels I'd rather much talk about, like Snatcher on the Sega CD. It's a good visual novel that actually has some gameplay to it, not to mention a better story. The unofficial ZX Spectrum port was my first exposure to the actual game, and while I never got a chance to play it until now, I consider it a bare-bones port nonetheless. It's pretty interesting that the Sceners were kinda able to bring the PC experience into the ZX Spectrum. The re-releases are pretty much the same experience as the ports preceding it, but it's pretty much nothing to write home about.
And despite its faults, I kinda like Three Sisters' story. It may not be the best game out there, but it sure as hell is a better Bond movie than No Time to Die. Now if you'll excuse me, I'm gonna go ahead and sleep in my bed questioning my decency for the next few hours. I should probably be fine by then.
It is very difficult for a short man to have sex with a tall man.
Whoops! God damn it, Freudian slip.